لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.
حدثنا موسى قال حدثنا أبو عوانة قال حدثنا عمر عن أبيه عن أبي هريرة قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إذا أصبح قال أصبحنا وأصبح الملك لله والحمد كله لله لا شريك له لا إله إلا الله إليه النشور وإذا أمسى قال أمسينا وأمسى الملك لله والحمد كله لله لا شريك له لا إله إلا الله وإليه المصير.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We continue with the Kitab al-Adab al-Mufrad by Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. And we begin the section regarding dua and the different types of dua the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made and the different etiquettes of dua and some of the reasons why the dua of a person are accepted and rejected. And in the previous lesson, we took an introduction to dua, mentioning some of the conditions of dua and the reasons and times of acceptance. Now that the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, بَابُ مَا يَقُولُ إِذَا أَصْبَحْ, the chapter of that which a person says in the morning. And Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, began this chapter in this way to show that the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would remember Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, continuously throughout the day and night. And the first part of the day, without doubt, is the morning. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to remember Allah jalla wa ala from the moment he would wake up until the moment he would pass away, until the moment he would go to sleep sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The author rahimahullah ta'ala mentions the hadith of Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu wa arda, and he said kana an-nabiyyu sallallahu alaihi wasallam idha asbaha qal, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he would wake up in the morning, he would say أَصْبَحْنَا وَأَصْبَحَ الْمُلْكُ لِلَّهِ, that we have, the أَصْبَحْنَا, that we have reached the morning and we have come to witness the morning. وَأَصْبَحَ الْمُلْكُ لِلَّهِ, and everything in the kingdom in this morning belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is from the adab of a believer to begin the day by mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by remembering the blessing of Allah jalla wa ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed him to live another day. And also by renewing his iman, by affirming that everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So not only has he acknowledged the blessing of Allah jalla wa ala upon himself, but he has renewed his iman that everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everything is bows down and submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we affirm the rububiyyah of Allah jalla wa ala, that he is the owner of everything. And that everything submits to him, and we acknowledge from this the uluhiyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Walhamdu kulluhu lillah, and then all praises and all thanks belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we glorify Allah jalla wa ala in the morning. La sharika lahu la ilaha illallah wa ilayhi nushur, and that he has no partner subhanahu wa ta'ala, that none has the right to be worshipped except for him. Wa ilayhi nushur, and we will go to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a person, when he wakes up in the morning, he begins his day by glorifying and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by acknowledging the blessings of this life, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with life, and He has blessed us with another day for us to worship Him and seek forgiveness for our shortcomings. We affirm the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His rububiyyah by acknowledging that everything belongs to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise and we glorify Him because of this. And then we acknowledge that only He deserves to be worshipped, and that we will return to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذَا أَمْسَى قَالًا, in the night time, the person, he says, أَمْسَيْنَا وَأَمْسَى الْمُلْكُ لِلَّهِ, that we have reached this night, and the entire creation belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the night. وَالْحَمْدُ كُلُّهُ لِلَّهِ, and all praises are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَإِلَيْهِ الْمَصِيرُ, and he has no partners, and none has the right to be worshipped except for him, and to him we will return subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So this is how the believer begins his day, and this is how the believer ends his day. And he mentions that he belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that he will return to Allah, because the sleep is like a person has passed away. Because he is unaware of what he is doing. He is unable to do whatever he wants. So it resembles death, and this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned these words, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some of the scholars have questioned the authenticity of this narration because of Umar in the chain, who is Umar ibn Abi Salama. And there is some weakness in this, but there are other narrations that support this with similar wording to it, and therefore there is no problem in this narration, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
حدثنا محمد بن سلام قال أخبرنا عبده قال أخبرنا محمد بن عمرو قال حدثنا أبو سلمة عن أبي هريرة قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إن الكريم ابن الكريم ابن الكريم ابن الكريم يوسف بن يعقوب بن إسحاق بن إبراهيم الخليل الرحمن عليهم السلام قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لو لبثت في السجن ما لبث يوسف ثم جاءني الداعي لأجبته إذ جاءه الرسول فقال ارجع إلى ربك فاسأله ما بال النسوة التي قطعن أيديهن ارجع إلى ربك فاسأله ما بال النسوة التي قطعن أيديهن ورحمة الله على لوط إن كان ليأوي إلى ركن شديد إذ قال لقومه أو أنني بكم قوة أو آوي إلى ركن شديد فما بعث الله بعده من نبي إلا في ثروة من قومه قال محمد الثروة الكثرة والمنعة.
Now the author رحمه الله تعالى he said باب من دعا في غيره من الدعاء. The chapter of the one who makes dua by other than it. Now what he intends by this is, he gave the dua for the morning and the evening. How the believer begins his day and how he concludes his day. And now Imam al-Bukhari wants to mention, not just from this chapter, but from the rest of the chapters, that there are many other du'as that you find in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not just from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But dua is open for a person to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever he wants. Even if these specific words are not found in the kitab and the sunnah. So a person asks subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever he wants, however he wants. As long as he fulfills the conditions of dua and he stays away from the preventers. No doubt the greatest du'as, as we will come to see, are the du'as that are found in the kitab and the sunnah. Because they encompass and they are very comprehensive and they encompass everything that a person could ever need and ask for. But sometimes a person wants to focus on something more specific, so he can make the general du'as that are found in the Quran and the sunnah, and then he can make any du'a that he wants. And the reason why Imam al-Bukhari mentioned this hadith in this chapter is to show you how the Prophet ﷺ, sometimes he's just speaking about someone and then he would make a dua for him. So it's not a specific reason why he stood up to make dua, nor was it a specific time that he made dua, but there was just an occasion he mentioned someone, so then he mentioned a dua and he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on him. So this hadith that has been mentioned by Imam al-Bukhari is in the Sahihain. It is muttafaqun alayh. From the hadith of Abi Huraira, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ الْكَرِيمِ إِبْنَ الْكَرِيمِ إِبْنَ الْكَرِيمِ إِبْنَ الْكَرِيمِ يُوسُفِ بِنْ يَعْقُوبِ بِنْ إِسْحَاقِ بِنْ إِبْرَاهِيمِ خَلِيلِ الرَّحْمَنِ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّلَامِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, indeed, the Honorable One, the Son of the Honorable One, the Son of the Honorable One, the Son of the Honorable One. Yusuf, the son of Ya'qub, the son of Ishaq, the son of Ibrahim, who is the friend of Ar-Rahman, alayhim as-salam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions how Yusuf alayhi salam was the honorable one. Because he was a prophet, the son of a prophet, the son of a prophet, the son of a prophet. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَوْ لَبِثْتُ فِي السِّجْنِ مَا لَبِثَ يُوسُفْ ثُمَّ جَاءَنِ الدَّاعِي لَأَجَبْتْ إذ جاءه الرسول فقال ارجع إلى ربك فاسأله ما بال النسوة التي قطعن أيديهن. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, if I was to remain in prison for as long as Yusuf alayhi salam remained in prison, I would have responded to the caller when he came. For when he came to Yusuf alayhi salam, he said, go back to your master and ask him what was the reason why the women they cut their hands. Now Yusuf alayhi salam, he remained in prison for a number of years. He remained in prison for a number of years, and then when he interpreted the dreams for those who were in prison, he said to one of them who was going to serve the king, or he said to him, when you go to him, remind him of me. But when he went as Allah Jalla wa'ala mentions in the Quran, shaitan made him forget. So Yusuf alayhi salam remained in prison for a number of years after this. Bid'a sinin, Allah Jalla wa'ala says in the Quran, for between 3 to 9 years. So he was already in prison for a long time, and then he remained in prison for a long time after this. So then when the king, he had a dream, and he wanted it to be interpreted, he asked, can anyone interpret this dream of mine? So this man remembered that Yusuf alayhi salam is the one who can interpret dreams. So he went to Yusuf alayhi salam and he said, the king wants his dream to be interpreted, so come out. So Yusuf alayhi salam, he said, no, go back to him and say, why did the women cut their hands? Because if Yusuf alayhi salam came out of prison like this, they would have thought he was a criminal and he deserved to be in prison. So Yusuf alayhi salam wanted to remain there until his innocence was proved. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, if I remained in prison for the time that Yusuf alayhi salam remained in prison, I would have responded to the da'i. I would have responded to the man that came to bring me out of prison. Some of the ulama, they had problems with this hadith. Does that mean the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam didn't have patience like Yusuf alayhi salam? Does that mean Yusuf alayhi salam had greater patience than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was able to bear more hardship than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? This is not the meaning of the hadith. And all of the scholars unanimously agree that this is not the meaning of the hadith. Because there is no good quality a Prophet had, except the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was given it. And there was nothing beloved to Allah Jalla wa'ala that any Prophet had, except Allah Jalla wa'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had things that were more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than it. So the scholar said, this is a statement that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, and it is something which is known in the language, to show respect for his brother Yusuf alayhi salam, and to show respect for another Prophet. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in many places we find in his sunnah that he would praise other Prophets, and he would mention good things about them, even though he sallallahu alayhi wasallam has been blessed with better things by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the reason he would mention this is to make his companions and his followers love these Prophets, and make them want to have these qualities that these Prophets had. Because they can already see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has these qualities. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants to show them that not only he has these qualities, also his brothers from the Anbiya, they also had these qualities. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to show the virtue of Yusuf alayhi salam, and how he was a patient person, and how he would care about his reputation, and how he would want to prove his innocence. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned the virtue of Yusuf alayhi salam in this manner. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, wa rahmatullahi ala Lut, and may the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon Lut. And this is the point of evidence from the hadith, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sometimes during a conversation, while he's giving an example, he would just make a dua. So this is not a specific time that he would take to make a dua, nor a specific occasion, but he would remember someone and then he would make a dua for him. And this is from his sunnah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So for a believer, just to frequently remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because dua is an ibadah. So a general conversation the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is having with someone, and then he worships Allah jalla wa ala during that conversation, where he makes dua for the person that he is talking about. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, wa rahmatullahi ala Lut, that may the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon Lut, in kana la ya'wi ila ruknin shadid, that he was looking for someone to help him. That Lut alayhi salam, when he was sent, he didn't have a family or a tribe that was backing him. He was alone in his da'wah. And he was calling the people to go away from their fawahish, from their evil deeds, and to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِذْ قَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ, that when he said to his people, لَوْ أَنَّ لِي بِكُمْ قُوَّةً أَوْ آوِي إِلَىٰ رُكْنٍ شَدِيدًا, if only I had strength, and I could go and turn to someone. فَمَا بَعَثَ اللَّهُ بَعْدَهُ مِن نَبِيٍّ إِلَّا فِي ثَرْوَةٍ مِّن قَوْمِهِ. So after Lut alayhi salam, Allah jalla wa ala never sent a prophet, except that he had some backing from his people. Except that he had a tribe that he could turn to. There's no doubt that all of the Anbiya of Allah Jalla wa Ala, they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it gives them comfort in this life when they have someone that they can turn to also in this life. That they can talk to about their problems. That they can stand up for them. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he found comfort when his uncle Abu Talib, he stood up for him. Even though he was a disbeliever. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would turn to Allah. And he would make dua to Allah. But a human being is someone, he needs comfort around him as well. So Allah Jalla wa Ala blessed him with Khadija radiyallahu anha. The first person the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned to for comfort. Then Allah Jalla wa Ala blessed him with his uncle, even though he was a disbeliever. And he would give him support. And his tribe would give him support. Even when Hamza radiallahu anh, he supported the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was a disbeliever at that time. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that after Lut alayhi salam, there wasn't a single Prophet that was sent, except that he had backing from his people, from his tribe, from his family. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made dua upon Lut alayhi salam, because he never had this. So the point of evidence from this hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make dua to Allah jalla wa ala whenever he had the opportunity. Because this is something which is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we also find how humble he was sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That he would sometimes mention qualities of other prophets to make them look greater than him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though he is the master of the children of Adam and the leader of the children of Adam. No.
حدثنا عمر بن حفص قال حدثنا أبي قال حدثنا الأعمش قال حدثني مالك بن الحارث عن عبد الرحمن بن يزيد قال كان الربيع يأتي القمة يوم الجمعة فإذا لم أكن ثمة أرسل إليه فجاء مرة ولست ثمة فلقيني القمة وقال لي ألم تر ما جاء به الربيع قال ألم تر أكثر ما يدعو الناس وما أقل إجابتهم وذلك أن الله عز وجل لا يقبل إلا النافلة من الدعاء قلت أوليس قد قال ذلك عبد الله قال وما قال قال عبد الله لا يسمع الله من مسمع ولا مراء ولا لاعب إلا داع دعا يثبت من قلبه قال فذكر القمع قال نعم.
Now the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he begins the chapter, Babu al-Nakhilati min al-Dua. The chapter of the greatest and the purest supplications. And al-Nakhila min al-Dua, this word al-Nakhila means that which is clear from anything that could destroy it. So the chapter of the greatest and the most sincere and most perfect dua that a person could make. Imam al-Bukhari now mentions a narration. He says, an Abdul Rahman ibn Yazid. The Abdul Rahman ibn Yazid, he said, كان الربيع يأتي القمة يوم الجمعة. That الربيع, and this is Rabi ibn Khuthaym, and he was known from the greatest of the Tabi'in, from the older of the Tabi'in, and he was someone who was known for his ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and someone who was known for his great fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it was mentioned in certain narrations that Rabi ibn Khuthaym, he actually dug a grave in his house. And every night he would lie down in this grave for a period of time, reminding himself of the qabr and the hereafter. So he was someone who had great fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was known for his ibadah and he was known for his wisdom. So Abdul Rahman ibn Yazid, he said, كان الربيع يأتي علقمة يوم الجمعة. That Rabi, he would approach علقمة on the day of Jum'ah. فَإِذَا لَمْ أَكُنْ ثَمَّةَ أَرْسَلُوا إِلَيْهِ. That when I was not there, they would call for me. فَجَاءَ مَرَّةً وَلَسْتُ ثَمَّ. So they said, and he came one day, so Rabi' he came one day, and I wasn't there. And I here is referring to Abdul Rahman ibn Yazid. فَلَقِيَنِي عَلْقَمَةُ وَقَالَ لِي أَلَمْ تَرَ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرَّبِيعُ. So here Rabi' would come on Yawm al-Jum'ah, and he's from the ulama of the Tabi'in, and he would go to Alqama, who is also from the ulama of the Tabi'in, and they would discuss knowledge on Yawm al-Jum'ah. So a time that they would sit together, and they would discuss the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Abdul Rahman ibn Yazid, he also used to be there, and they used to discuss knowledge and they used to share knowledge. So whenever Abdul Rahman was not there, they would call for him so they could discuss knowledge together. And this is how knowledge, it becomes firm in a person's heart. When a person discusses knowledge with those who are on equal level with him, so they can benefit each other with things that they may have missed out. And this is something that we know that Imam Ahmad used to do with his companions. And Yahya ibn Ma'in used to do with his companions. And Sufyan al-Thawri used to do with his companions. That they used to sit down and they used to discuss knowledge with one another so they can revise what they have and they can increase in that which they do not have. So they would discuss knowledge and Abdul Rahman ibn Yazid used to be there with them. And if he was not there, they would call for him. But one day he missed it and they couldn't find him. So after Rabi' had left, then Alqama, he went to Abdul Rahman and he said, أَلَمْ تَرَ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرَّبِيعِ. Did you not see like what Rabi' had come with? قَالَ أَلَمْ تَرَ أَكْثَرَ مَا يَدْعُ النَّاسِ وَمَا أَقَلَّ إِجَابَتَهُمْ. The Rabi, he said, do you not see how frequently the people make dua and how little their dua is accepted? So do you not see how often the people make dua and how rarely we find that their dua is accepted? وَذَلِكَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا النَّاخِلَةَ مِنَ الدُّعَى. And he said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not accept the purest of the dua. So Rabi' at the time of the Tabi'in, he is realizing this. And remember, the tabi'een are those who are with the sahaba. And they are the students of the sahaba. So he's saying, do you not see how often people make dua today? But how little we find the response from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah jalla wa ala very rarely accepts the du'as. And this is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only accepts the pure du'as. The du'as that are free from anything that can make it void. So Abdul Rahman, he said, أَوَلَيْسَ قَدْ قَالَ ذَلِكَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ. So now, Alqama and Abdul Rahman, they are discussing now. So Abdul Rahman, he says to Alqama, he said, isn't this exactly what Abdullah, he said? And he's referring here to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. So Alqama, he hasn't heard this. So he said, وَمَا قَالَ. What did Abdullah say? He said, قَالَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ ibn Mas'ud, he said, لَا يَسْمَعُ اللَّهُ مِن مُسَمِّعٍ وَلَا مُرَائٍ وَلَا لَاعِبٍ إِلَّا دَاعٍ دُعًا يَثْبُتُ مِن قَلْبِهِ. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't listen to the dua of a person who is saying a dua for others to hear. Nor does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listen to a dua of the person who is showing off. Nor does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listen to a person who makes a dua and he is playing. And what does he mean by playing? A person who is not giving importance to his dua and he doesn't have concentration and focus in his dua, meaning his heart is not present when he is making the dua. And Allah jalla wa ala only listens to the person whose dua is firm from his heart. So this is what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he mentioned. قَالَ فَذَكَرَ عَلْقَمَ قَالَ نَعْمَ. So people asked Abdul Rahman afterward, did Alqama remember what you said? He said, yes, he remembered what I said. So the point of this narration is that the dua a person makes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it has to be free from showing off. Free from anything that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this was mentioned in the conditions that we took in the previous lesson. So when a person is making dua, if he's making dua just so people around him can hear that he's making dua, his dua will be rejected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he is making dua just to show people that he's a pious person and he's someone that frequently makes dua, again his dua will be rejected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he is someone who is making dua but he's not really focused, he just said, I'm just going to move my lips and I'm going to make dua. It's not coming from the heart, he's not focused, he doesn't have concentration, this dua is not going to be heard by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah jalla wa ala will only accept the dua which is pure, which is sincere, which is only for his sake. The dua which has come from his heart, where he is concentrating, he is focusing, he really wants Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it. This is the pure dua that Allah jalla wa ala accepts. And other than this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want to listen to it, he doesn't want to accept it subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find from this hadith, one of the conditions of dua is for it to be sincere for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also for it to come from the heart and for a person to be serious when he is asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also find the dangers of showing off, that this prevents a person's dua from being accepted. And the dangers of a person wanting to be noticed, because this also prevents his dua from being accepted. Yeah. We also subhanAllah find from this that the respect that the people of knowledge are supposed to have for one another. And the scholars would come to each other and they would discuss their knowledge. If one of them missed out and he was unable to attend, they would go and they would explain what had happened to what they learned and what they gained from there. And if he had knowledge, then he would also spread this and they would learn like this together.
عن العلاء عن أبيه عن أبي هريرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم قال إذا دعا أحدكم فلا يقول إن شئت وليعزم المسألة وليعظم الرغبة فإن الله عز وجل لا يعظم عليه شيء أعطاه.
ما إمام البخاري رحمه الله تعالى he says باب ليعزم الدعاء فإن الله لا مكره له. The chapter of a person being firm in his dua. Being firm in his dua because no one can force Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do anything. The chapter of a person being firm in his dua because no one can force Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do anything. He gives the hadith of Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu wa arda. And this hadith is muttafaqun alayh. So it's in the sahih of Imam al-Bukhari and also in the sahih of Imam Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا دَعَا أَحَدُكُمْ فَلَا يَقُولْ إِن شِئْتَ. If any of you makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then do not say if you wish. So this is like a person making a dua and then he's saying, inshaAllah. Or he's making a dua and he says, oh Allah, if you want to give this to me, then give it to me. This is the meaning. A person is not allowed to make a dua and then say, in shit. Because when a person says in shit, like, oh Allah, give this to me if you wish. What does this mean? Firstly, it shows you that the person, he's not really firm in what he's asking. Because he's saying, oh Allah, give this to me only if you want. So it's a sign that he's not really bothered about what he's asking. That he's not firm in asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's just saying, oh Allah, if you want to give it to me, then give it to me. A person needs to show his need to Allah jalla wa ala, that he really wants what he's asking for. So he says, oh Allah, give me this. Oh Allah, please give this to me. Oh Allah, give this to me. He's asking like this. This is how a believer should ask. So when a person says, oh Allah, give this to me only if you wish, it shows that he's not firm in asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It also gives the impression that maybe the thing that he's asking for is so great. That is so great that, you know, so maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say no because it's so great. So he's saying, oh Allah, just give it to me if you wish. So it gives that impression that maybe the person believes that he's asking for something which is so great. Also, it might give the impression that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may not be able to give this. Or something may be preventing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from giving this. So the Prophet ﷺ prohibited us from saying in shit or insha'Allah when we are making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا دَعَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلَا يَقُلْ. That if any of you are making dua, then let him not say in shit, that if you wish. وَلْيَعْزِمِ الْمَسْأَلَةِ. That be firm in your asking. That be serious when you are asking and be firm when you are asking. وَلْيُعَظِّمِ الرَّغْبَةِ. And greaten the thing that you are asking for. That make it great. Make the things that you want from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala great. Do not just ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something small. Do not ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something that you can just get by. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something great. Why? فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُعْظُمُ عَلَيْهِ شَيْءٌ أَعْطَى. Because nothing is great for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give. He can give you whatever you ask for. Ask for the greatest possible thing, it is not too great for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You could have mountains and mountains and years of sins, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive you because it is not too great for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. You could be the worst person on this earth, make a sincere forgiveness, a repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then ask Him for the highest Jannah. This is not too great for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So be firm in your asking because nothing is too great for Allah jalla wa ala. Do not say, oh Allah, if you wish, give it to me. Be firm. And this is how the dua of a person is accepted. No.
قال أخبرنا إسماعيل بن علي عن عبد العزيز بن الصحيب عن أنس قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إذا دعا أحدكم فليعزم في الدعاء ولا يقول اللهم إن شئت فأعطني فإن الله عز وجل لا مستكره له.
Now Imam al-Bukhari mentions another narration with the same meaning. He says, on the authority of Anas radiallahu an, and this hadith is also muttafaqun alayh, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا دَعَا أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَعْزِمْ فِي الدُّعَى. If any of you makes dua, then make his dua firm. وَلَا يَقُلْ. And do not say, اللَّهُمَّ إِن شِئْتَ فَأَعْطِنِي. Oh Allah, give it, if you wish, then give it to me. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا مُسْتَكْرِهَ لَهُ. Because nothing can force Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing can compel Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing can prevent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from giving you whatever He wants. So be firm when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and ask Him Allah, and ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala for the greatest, because He can never, He can give whatever He wants, and nothing is impossible for Him. No.
رفي أيدي في الدعاء. حدثنا إبراهيم بن المنذر قال حدثنا محمد بن كليب قال أخبرني أبي عن أبي نعيم وهو وهب قال رأيت ابن عمر وابن الزبير يدعوان يديران بالراحتين على الوجه.
Now Imam Bukhari رحمه الله تعالى begins the chapter باب رفع الأيدي في الدعاء, the chapter of raising the hands when making dua. The chapter of raising the hands when making dua. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to raise his hands frequently when he used to make dua. And Imam al-Suyuti, he said, I have counted 100 places where he raised his hands sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I have counted 50 different circumstances where he raised his hands sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is known, a very well known sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he would raise his hands to Allah jalla wa ala when making dua. As Imam al-Suyuti said, 100 places he can count from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that he raised his hands. And 50 different circumstances where he raised his hands sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is from the etiquettes of dua. And this is from the reasons of a dua to be accepted. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيِّيٌّ كَرِيمٌ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is shy. He is the one who is the most honorable, the most generous, subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَسْتَحِي مِنْ عَبْدِهِ إِذَا رَفَعَ إِلَيْهِ يَدَيْهِ أَنْ يَرُدَّهُمَا صِفْرًا, that he becomes shy of his slave when he raises his hands to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to leave them with nothing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes shy to leave a person with nothing when he raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this shows us it's from the great etiquettes of dua to raise a person's hands. And when a person raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it also shows that he has a great need. Because it is like he's now begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he's raising his hands. So it shows a great need. It also shows his tawheed, that he knows that Allah jalla wa ala is above him. And he knows that he has to raise his hands above for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept. So it also renews and reaffirms his iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Allah jalla wa ala is high above, and that he is the one who is low, and he is the one that is weak, and he is in need of the one who is greater than him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to raise his hands in different ways. And the scholars have said, to summarize it, we can say there are four different ways the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make dua. The first of them is he would raise his hands extremely high. And to the extent that the Sahaba, they said, we could see his armpit, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some of them misunderstood, like some of the scholars misunderstood some of the narration, and they said this meant that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make dua, and he would have his hands the other way round, because some of the hadith mentioned that he was making his dua to the extent that his palms were facing the floor. So some of the ulama, they misunderstood this, and they said that he would make dua like this. And if you make dua like this, how are your palms? They're facing the floor. But this is not correct. He was making his dua like this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That his hands were as high as they could be, so his palms were facing the floor. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do this when he used to make dua for rain. So if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in the masjid, and he was delivering the khutbah, and then he would make dua for rain, he would raise his hands as high as he could, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he would also raise his hands like this when matters became very severe upon the Muslims. And he would make dua for something which was very severe, he would raise his hands in this manner, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when a person is in the khutbah and he's listening to the imam and the khatib, he is making dua. It is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the companions to raise their hands when the khatib makes dua, except when he's making dua for rain. And that's why you'd find in the countries that do not have rain, or very rarely does it rain, you would find the people will not raise their hands in the dua, but when the khatib begins to make dua for rain, then all of them would raise their hands for dua. And in this country we do not see this because we have more rain than anything else. So it is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ to only raise the dua on the mimbar when he is doing the khutbah, when he is asking for rain, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he would raise his hands when he has great need, and he would raise it as high as he could, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so the palms would face the floor. This is the first way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make dua. The second way, and this is the most common way, is the Prophet ﷺ would have his hands in front of him. So he would not raise them to the extent that you could see his armpit, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he would have his hands in front of him. He would have his palms together, and he would have his hands in front of him, either on the level of his shoulders or the level of his face, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is how he would make dua, and this is the most common way he would make dua, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the default position of making dua. So if a person, he just wants to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is the default position that a person would have his hands in when he makes dua. So any time a person just thinks about making dua, he's sitting down, he wants to make dua, the default position is to put his hands together and to put them on the level of his face or his shoulders, and then to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like this. The third way he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make dua is by raising his finger. And he would do this when he was giving when he would be giving the khutbah. So during the sermon, if he was making dua, he would raise his finger like this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is only sunnah for the khatib and not for those who are sitting down. So he would raise his finger when he would make dua. And also, as the ulama have mentioned, he would raise his finger in tashahud when he would make dua. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he is making the tashahud and he's making dua and dhikr throughout the tashahud, his finger would be raised, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he would make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the fourth way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make dua is just by making dua without raising his hands or his finger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is also permissible. And there are times he did this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like when he would complete the salah. When he would complete the salah, he wouldn't say astaghfirullah, 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 and raise his hand when he's saying this. When he would complete the salah, he would not change his hands, he would just make dua to Allah Jalla wa'ala without raising his hands and without raising his finger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also when he would make tawaf, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would make tawaf, when he would go from Safa to Marwa, he would make dhikr and dua, but it is not reported that he would raise his hands, nor would he raise his finger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this shows the permissibility of making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without raising the hands and without raising the fingers. So if a person, maybe he was lying on his side, he can just make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and there's no need to raise his hands. If he wants to raise his hands, then this is better. But to raise the hands after the salah to make dua, this is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if a person was to say astaghfirullah, 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 Allahumma anta salam like this and raise his hands, then he would be performing an act of bid'ah. However, if a person forgot to make a particular dua in the salah, and after he has done his dhikr, he wants to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then there is no harm in him raising his hands, with the condition that he does not make this a practice of the salah. So in some masajid we go to, you would find after every farad salah, what do? They make dua. This is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And by making this an ibadah that they do after the salah, it becomes a bid'ah. But for a person, if he has forgotten to make a dua, or something has crept into his mind now and he knows that he has to make dua for something, and then he raises his hands, and whether this is after the salah or while he's walking or any other time he raises his hands, then there is no harm in this because he hasn't linked this raising the hands or this specific dua to the completion of the salah. So this is permissible and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So this is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after insha'a ta'ala. This is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the ways he would raise his hands when he's making dua. We also find one of the times that he would not raise his hands or his finger is in the sajda. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is known that he used to make dua when he was in sujood and he would not raise his hands sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he's in sujood. So the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in sajda to make dua is just to be in the position of sajda and to make dua like this. Now Imam al-Bukhari mentions the narration of Abi Nu'aym, who is Wahab. He said, رَأَيْتُ إِبْنُ عُمَرْ وَابْنَ الزُّبَيْرِ يَدْعُوَانَ. I saw Ibn Umar and Ibn al-Zubayr making dua. يُدِيرَانِ بِالرَّاحَتَيْنِ عَلَى الْوَجْهِ. They would like make they would wipe their, or move their hands or palms on their face. They would move their palms on their face. So Imam Bukhari begins this. So this is to show that their hands were raised. And maybe they were moving their palms, maybe they were wiping their face. And this is mentioned in this narration. And in this narration, there is Fulayh, and he is unknown. Or there is weakness in him, and therefore this narration is weak. And Shaykhul Islam ibn Taymiyyah commented on this, and he said, every single narration that shows the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wiped his face after dua has some level of weakness. Every single narration that shows the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wiped his face after dua has some level of weakness. And therefore, it is not an established sunnah for a person to wipe his face after dua. There are some scholars, as I mentioned, I think in the previous lesson, that did authenticate some of the narrations. Like Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and others, they did authenticate some of the narrations. So we cannot be too harsh to those who wipe their faces, because there are narrations that have been authenticated by some of the muhaddithin. But as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, what seems to be correct is that the narrations are weak, and there is nothing that actually proves that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did wipe his face after making dua. No.
عن سماك بن حوض عن عكرمة عن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها زعم أنه سمعه منها أنها رأت النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يدعو رافعا يديه يقول إنما أنا بشر فلا تعاقبني أيما رجل من المؤمنين آذيته أو شتمته فلا تعاقبني فيه.
The Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala gives the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, and a similar narration to this has been collected in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. She said, أنها رأت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يدعو رافعا يديه. She saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم make dua and his hands were raised. And this is the point of evidence that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he would make dua and he would raise his hands صلى الله عليه وسلم. يقول إنما أنا بشر فلا تعاقبني. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in his dua he would say, Oh Allah, he said, indeed I am only a human being, so do not punish me. أيما رجل من المؤمنين آذيته أو شتمته فلا تعاقبني فيه. If there is any believer that I have harmed or I have cursed, then do not hold me to account for this. Now subhanAllah, who is saying this dua? This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is raising his hands to Allah jalla wa ala, and then he is making himself humble in this manner. Oh Allah, I'm just a human being, so please do not punish me. I have harmed some people, I may have cursed some people, please do not hold me to account for this. This shows you how the Anbiya of Allah Jalla wa'ala are even scared, subhanAllah, of the meeting of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And if the prophets who have been forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah Jalla wa'ala forgave all of his past sins and any sin that he would ever do, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And even though this he knew he was guaranteed and he was promised Jannah, he would still make dua asking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Especially if he had ever wronged anyone. And would he ever wrong anyone sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? No. But he would make dua to Allah Jalla wa'ala, if I have ever done anything, then please forgive me. If I have wronged anyone, if I have harmed anyone, then forgive me. I'm just a human being and I make mistakes. But the point of evidence is the raising the dua is from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we also find from this how the muhaddithin, the scholars of hadith, they preserved every detail of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A person cannot just say we should raise our hands to make dua because it's something which a person looks like he's begging and he's asking. But this has to be affirmed in the kitab or the sunnah if we are to take this as religion. And the muhaddithin, they affirmed everything the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. Certain things that we do not even need because they are from the daily things that a person would do. Like a person would touch a child's head out of rahmah. They said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did this to show that it's encouraged to do this. So they would never leave anything in these hands. Just the fact that he raised his hands, the Sahaba, they saw this. They knew this is an act of the deen. Therefore they transmitted it. And we find that the muhaddithin, they recorded this in their books. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا علي قال حدثنا سفيان قال حدثنا أبو الزناد عن الأعرج عن أبي هريرة قال قدم الطفيل بن عمرو بن توسيع على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم قال يا رسول الله إن دوسا قد عصت وأبت فادعو الله عليها فاستقبل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم القبلة ورفع يديه فظن الناس أنه يدعو عليهم فقال اللهم اهدي دوسا وات بهم.
Now Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala gives the hadith of Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu wa radah. And the hadith of Abi Hurairah is muttafaqun alayh. It's collected in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari and also in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. He said, قَدِمَ الطُفَيْلُ بْنُ عَمَرْ الدَّوْسِ عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ طُفَيْلُ ibn Amr الدَّوْسِ, he came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he was from the tribe of Dawsi. He said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, O Messenger of Allah, إِنَّ دَوْسًا قَدْ عَصَتْ وَأَبَتْ. Meaning, so he would have gone to those, his tribe, to give da'wah to them and call them to Islam. And they didn't respond to him. So he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, O Messenger of Allah, indeed this tribe, those, asat, that they disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa abat, and they refused to accept Islam. Fad'u Allah alayha. So make dua to Allah against them. Now he saw that he was not successful in their da'wah, and they may have been rude to him, they refused to obey Allah, and they refused to submit and accept Islam. So he said, O Messenger of Allah, make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against them. فَاسْتَقْبَلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ الْقِبْلَةَ وَرَفَعَ يَدَيْهِ. Now this is a very important point in the hadith, and a very strong point of evidence for dua. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he turned and he faced the qibla. And then he raised his hands. This shows you that the qibla is, the Kaaba is not just the qibla for salah. It is also the qibla for what? For dua. The Kaaba is also the qibla for dua. And this is a refutation to some of the sects that have gone astray. For those that do claim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not above, like from those from the Asha'ira and other than them, they say that the qibla for dua is the sky. Because the believer raises his hands to the sky, and the believer's heart is attached to the sky. So in order for them to deny that Allah Jalla wa Ala is there, they have said that this is the qibla for dua. It doesn't mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above, it is the fact that the qibla for dua is the sky. And this hadith is a clear refutation, the hadith is muttafaqun alayh. That the qibla for dua is not the sky. We raise our hands to the sky because Allah Jalla wa Ala is above the skies. And our heart is attached to the sky because Allah Jalla wa Ala is above the sky. So our heart is attached to the direction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because it is attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the qibla is the Kaaba. The qibla for dua is the Kaaba. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he turned to the qibla, which is the Kaaba. He turned to the Kaaba sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he raised his hands. فَظَنَّ النَّاسِ أَنَّهُ يَدْعُو عَلَيْهِمْ. So the people began to think that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was going to make dua against those. فَقَالَ اللَّهُمَّ اهْدِ دَوْسًا وَأْتِ بِهِمْ. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, O Allah, guide those, the tribe those, and bring them. Guide those and bring them. And what happened later on? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided this tribe and they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are many benefits in this hadith. From them, the permissibility of asking someone to make dua. And this is with the condition that the person is alive, he is present, and he is able. Also, this shows the permissibility of making dua for the mushrikeen. And Imam al-Bukhari, he gave this title in his sahih. The permissibility of making dua for the mushrikeen. The Prophet ﷺ made dua for the mushrikeen. And he made dua for the mushrikeen to be guided, because they were from the mushrikeen. So it shows the permissibility of making dua for the mushrikeen. Some of the believers think it is only permissible to make dua against the mushrikeen. And this is not correct. It is permissible to make dua for them, and it is permissible to make dua against them. If they are oppressive people, and they have hatred towards Islam and the Muslims, then it is permissible to make dua against them. And if they are people who maybe are inclined towards Islam, then it is recommended for a person to make dua that they are guided to in Islam. We also find the mercy that the Prophet ﷺ had. That if there were people who were disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wouldn't just turn and want azab for them. He would begin with having rahmah for them. And he would begin and he would try to call them to Islam, try to draw their hearts to Islam. If after everything they did not want Islam, then he ﷺ would turn against them. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We also find from this the sunnah of raising the hands when making dua.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا محمد بن سلام قال أخبرنا إسماعيل بن جعفر عن حميد عن أنس قال قحط المطر عاما فقام بعض المسلمين إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يوم الجمعة فقال يا رسول الله قحط المطر واجدبت الأرض وهلك الماء فرفع يديه وما يرى في السماء من سحابة فمد يديه حتى رأيت بياض خفيه يستسقي الله فنص إلينا الجمعة حتى أهم الشاب القريب الدار الرجوع إلى أهله فدامت جمعة فلما كانت الجمعة التي تليها فقال يا رسول الله تهدمت البيوت واحتبس الركبان فتبسم في سرعة ملاذ ابن آدم وقال بيده اللهم حوالينا ولا علينا فتكشطت عن المدينة.
Now Imam al-Bukhari رحمه الله تعالى mentions the hadith of Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنه. And a similar narration to this is mentioned in the Sahihain. He said, قحط المطر عاما. That in 1 year the water was very little and the rain, it hardly rained until the earth became very dry. And if the earth has become very dry, it means that the crops are going to die. It means the animals are not going to have anything to live on and they will also die as well. So this happened in Medina. فقام بعض المسلمين إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم الجمعة. So some of the Muslims, they stood to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the day of Jumu'ah. And in the narration in the Sahih, it's mentioned that while he was giving the khutbah, someone came and then they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَحِتَ الْمَطَرُ وَأَجْدَبَتِ الْأَرْضِ وَهَلَكَ الْمَالِ. They said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Messenger of Allah, the rain has stopped, the earth has dried, and our wealth has perished. The rain has stopped, the earth has dried, and our wealth has perished. Meaning our animals are dying. We have our crops have died. We have nothing from our wealth left. فَرَفَعَ يَدَيْهِ وَمَا يُرَى فِي السَّمَاءِ مِنْ سَحَابَةٍ فَمَدَّ يَدَيْهِ حَتَّى رَأَيْتُ بَيَاضَ إِبْطَيْهِ يَسْتَسْقِ اللَّهِ. The Prophet ﷺ, he raised his hands. And he said, you cannot see a single cloud in the sky. And then he extended his hands so you can see the whiteness of his armpit ﷺ. That he was asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for rain. And some of the scholars mentioned that they couldn't actually see the whiteness of his armpit sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was his clothing there, but if his clothing wasn't there, then you would be able to see the whiteness of his armpits. فَمَا صَلَّيْنَا الْجُمُعَ حَتَّى أَهَمَّ الشَّابَّ الْقَرِيبَ الدَّارِ الرُّجُوعُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ. And we hadn't completed the Jum'ah, except that a young person would find it difficult to go back to his house because of the severity of the rain. So you can see, subhanAllah, how Allah Jalla wa Ala accepted the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if you actually look at the riwayah in the Sahihain, it's mentioned that there was no cloud in the sky. And then they said, and a cloud, it came from far and it came over our heads. And then it began to expand. And then it poured down. So the narrator over here, Anas ibn Malik, he's giving the example of a young person. Because you can say, maybe an old person will have difficulty going to his house if it is raining. But he's saying a young person now, a young strong person, will find it difficult to go to his house, which is just around the corner, because of the amount it was raining and the severity of the rain. فَدَامَتْ جُمْعَةٌ. It rained for an entire week. فَلَمَّا كَانَتِ الْجُمْعَةُ الَّتِي تَلِيهَا When the following Jum'ah came, فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ So the people, they came again. And this person came again. And in the riwayah in the Sahih, Anas ibn Malik, he said, I cannot recall if this person who came on Jum'ah was the same person who came in the previous Jum'ah. But he said, O Messenger of Allah, تَهَدَّمَتِ الْبُيُوتِ O Messenger of Allah, the houses are being destroyed. وَاحْتَسَبَ الرُّكْبَانِ And the people are unable to, يعني, the people are unable to move with their animals, they're unable to come into our land. Like meaning that it's raining so heavily. فَتَبَسَّمَ لِسُرْعَةِ مَلَالِ ابْنِ آدَمِ The Prophet ﷺ began to smile at how quickly the children of Adam become bored and are displeased of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَقَالَ بِيَدِهِ And then he said with his hands, so he moved his hands, he raised his hands, and he said, اللَّهُمَّ حَوَالَيْنَا وَلَا عَلَيْنَا He said, Oh Allah, push the, make it rain in the places around us and not on us. فَتَكَشَّطَتْ عَنِ الْمَدِينَةِ So the clouds, they cleared on Medina. So there were no longer any clouds over Medina. Now we find from this hadith many benefits. From amongst them, the permissibility of the khatib making dua for rain. And the khatib raising his hands when he makes dua. And we also find the sunnah of how to raise their hands when a person makes dua. We also find from this hadith that a person can make dua for something that he feels to be unlikely, like very unlikely that it could take place, but Allah Jalla wa'ala has the ability to do everything. So meaning the people, they hadn't seen rain for a long time. And there were no clouds in the sky, the signs for the rain were not even there. But did that make them lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the ability of Allah Jalla wa'ala? No. They asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then Allah Jalla wa'ala can bring a cloud from wherever he wants subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he can make it rain however he wants subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we also find from this that the dua can be accepted of a person even if he thinks that maybe the signs of the things are not around him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can make it happen. A person will say, look, I don't have a very high education. I don't have يعني, many qualifications. Does that mean that you can't get a job? No, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will allow you to get a job. Does that mean that you can't have something that's going to bring you a lot of rizq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and give you a high wage? No, it doesn't mean this. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He will provide for you subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also find from this the permissibility of complaining about some of the things that are happening with the condition that a person is not complaining about the actual actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were complaining their affairs to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they were not disliking the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is permissible. We also find from this the permissibility to smile. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled. Because some people will say that, and many people think that to be a Salafi or to be someone upon Sunnah, you have to have a strict face and a harsh face. This was not like the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He used to smile, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They were able to see his teeth at times, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And this is from his Sunnah. And that's why he says, smiling is Sadaqah. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam smiled. And it shows you how the children of Adam, they will be ungrateful for some of the blessings that they have, or they will become bored of the blessings very quickly. As mentioned here by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we also find a sunnah du'a for a person to make at the time of severe rain that could harm them, to say Allahumma hawalaina wa la alaina, to say oh Allah send the rain around us and not on us. And the riwayah in Sahih Bukhari mentions more du'as, that Allahumma hawalaina wa la alaina, that Allahumma then he said oh Allah send it to the hills and send it to the mountains and send it to the other areas and not the areas of our land. And then it shows you how the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the mercy of Allah jalla wa ala can come instantly when a person makes dua, that Allah jalla wa ala, He cleared the skies immediately. And in the riwayah in the Sahih, it mentions that when they completed the Jum'ah salah, they came out and it was extremely sunny and extremely hot. So it shows you how quickly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the point of evidence from this hadith is to show you that sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would raise his hands very high. And this was in times of severity, and especially in times when he wanted rain, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Qala rahimahullahu ta'ala, haddathana as-salt, qala haddathana abu awana an sallab, an ikrima an a'ishata radiyallahu ta'ala anha, annahu sami'abu minha, annaha ra'atin nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yad'u raqilan yad'u yaqul, Allahumma, إنما أنا بشر فلا تعاقبني أيما رجل من المؤمنين آذيته أو شتمته فلا تعاقبني فيه
Imam al-Bukhari now repeats the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha with a different chain, and this is in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, that she saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raising his hand and then saying, Oh Allah, I am just a human being, so please do not punish me. If I have harmed or cursed anyone, any believer, then please do not do not hold me to account for this. So just to emphasize that if the prophets are making dua for such things, then we should also make dua for these things. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا عارم قال حدثنا حماد بن زيد قال حدثنا حجاج بن حجاج الصواف عن أبي الزبير عن جابر بن عبد الله أن الطفيل بن عمرو قال للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هل لك في حسن ومنعة حسن دوس قال فأبى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لما ذكر الله للأنصار فهاجر الطفيل وهاجر معه رجل من قومه فمرض الرجل فضجر وكلمة شبيهة بها فحبى إلى قرن فأخذ مشخصا فقطع ودجيه فمات فرآه الطفيل في المنام فقال ما فعل بك قال غفر لي بهجرتي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم قال ما شأن يديك قال فقيل إنا لا نشرك منك ما أكسبت من يديك قال فقصح الطفيل على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال اللهم وليديه فاغفر ورفع يديه.
Now Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned the hadith of Jabir ibn Abdullah. And the hadith is in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. Except for the last two words, وَرَفَعَ يَدَيْهِ, that the Prophet ﷺ raised his hands. So this part of the hadith is da'if. But the rest of the hadith is in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. He said, أَنَّ الطُفَيْلِ ibn Amr قَالَ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. That Tufayl ibn Amr, he said to the Prophet صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, هَلَّكَ فِي حِسْنٍ وَمَنَعَةٍ حِسْنِ دَوْسٍ. He said, you have a fortress and you have the full support of a people. What about the fortress of the people of Dos? So he is now asking the Prophet ﷺ, if the Prophet ﷺ, he wants the support of any people, these are the people that are going to support him. These are the people that he can turn to help for. So the Prophet ﷺ, فَأَبَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The Prophet ﷺ refused this. لِمَا ذَخَرَ اللَّهُ لِلْأَنصَارِ. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reserved this special right to the Ansar. That this privilege was given to the Ansar. And this is something that we find in other hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That after the conquest of Mecca, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was giving out the war booty, he gave to many of the people of Mecca. Like Abu Sufyan was asking for himself, he was asking for his children. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave valleys of animals to people to draw their hearts to Islam and to strengthen the Islam. And he never gave the Ansar a single thing. So the Ansar became upset. Now a lot of people misunderstand the hadith, and they think the Ansar became upset because the Prophet ﷺ didn't give them anything. The Ansar didn't care about this dunya. And they were not upset because the Prophet ﷺ didn't give them anything. They were upset because they thought that now that Mecca has been conquered, the Prophet ﷺ has forgotten about them, and he's going to give everything to the Muhajir, the people of Mecca, and he's going to remain with the people of Mecca. This is why they were upset. So when the Prophet ﷺ saw this, then he reminded the Ansar that he has become a person from the Ansar. He said that if the Ansar were to take the valleys and the pathways, and the rest of the people were to go elsewhere, I would take the same valleys and the same pathways as the Ansar. The Ansar, the Prophet ﷺ said, they are the inner garment, the garment that touches his skin. And the rest of the people are the outer garment. Meaning the Ansar have become close to the Prophet ﷺ. And this is what made the Ansar happy. And then the Prophet ﷺ gave them advice. And he said, you will see a lot of fitna after I pass away. So be patient until you meet me at the Hawd, which is the pool of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a privilege that Allah jalla wa ala reserved for the Ansar. And it cannot be given to anyone else. So when he said, O Messenger of Allah, do you want support? Do you want a fortress? We will give you the support. The tribe of those will give you everything. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam refused because this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose specifically for the Ansar. فهاجر الطفيل وهاجر معه رجل من قومه. So now Tufayl, he made hijrah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He came to Medina, and a man from his tribe also made hijrah to Medina. فمرض الرجل فضجر أو كلمة شبيهة بها. The person who came with Tufayl, he became ill, and he became extremely ill. He couldn't bear the severity of the illness that he had. فحبى إلى قرن فأخذ مشقصا فقطع ودجيه فمات. So this person who couldn't bear the hardship of this illness and the severity of it, he crawled to the quiver that he had where they would keep the arrows. He took an arrow and he cut the veins on his neck until he passed away. So he killed himself. Who was this man? Was he a believer or a disbeliever? He was a believer. He made hijrah to the Prophet ﷺ. And he became so severely ill that he couldn't take the pain. He crawled to the quiver that he had. He took the arrow and he cut his neck and he died. فَرَآهُ الطُّفَيْلُ فِي الْمَنَامِ Then Tufail, he saw him in his dream. فَقَالَ مَا فُعِلَ بِكَ And he said, what has happened to you? This man, he replied, this was in the dream. He said, غُفِرَ لِي بِهِجْرَتِي إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ He said, I was forgiven because of the hijrah I made to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then Tufail, he said, مَا شَأْنُ يَدَيْكَ What is up with your hands? He said, فَقِيلَ إِنَّا لَا نُصْلِحُ مِنْكَ مَا أَفْسَدْتَ مِنْ يَدَيْكَ Then he said to him, what has happened to your hands? He said, it was said to me that we are not going to rectify for you that which you have destroyed with your own hands. Meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he used his hands to kill himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take this away from him. فَقَصَّهَ الطُّفَيْلَ عَلَى النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ This is what he saw in his dream. So he mentioned his dream to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, اللَّهُمَّ وَلِيَدَيْهِ فَاغْفِرْ Oh Allah, forgive his hands. Oh Allah, forgive his hands. And in this riwayah, it mentions وَرَفَعْ يَدَيْهِ And this point, the raising of the hands in this hadith is weak. Because the riwayah in Sahih Muslim does not mention that Allah, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم raised his hands at that point. But the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made dua that Allah جل وعلا rectifies his hands. And Allah Jalla wa'ala cures his hands. And Allah Jalla wa'ala gives him back his hands. Now there are many benefits that we can find in this hadith. Firstly, the virtue of the Ansar. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this virtue to the Ansar that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be kept by them. And he will return to them. And he will always be with them. And he will die while he is amongst them. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We also find the virtues of hijrah. That hijrah is something which is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also find that a person who kills himself does not become a disbeliever. Like some of the Khawarij, they said that killing yourself is a major sin and it is disbelief. And they use the hadith that whoever, for example, jumps off a mountain, he will jump off a mountain for eternity. And whoever kills himself in a particular way, drinks poison, he will be drinking poison for eternity. So they said, because the hadith mentions for eternity, it shows you that they are disbelievers. And we said, these are hadith are proof that eternity over there doesn't mean for eternity. Eternity means that this person, he will be doing this for such a long time, it will seem as if it is for eternity. Because the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be severe upon him, if Allah jalla wa'ala chooses to punish him. And other scholars have interpreted it to mean that this person deserves to be punished for eternity. But because he had tawheed and iman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not punish him for eternity. So these are the meanings of those hadith. So this shows that the person who kills himself does not die as a disbeliever. And it also shows you the permissibility of making dua upon the one who kills himself. It shows you the permissibility of making dua for the one who kills himself. So if a person kills himself, we cannot say, oh, this person is an evil person and begin to make dua against him. If this person was a Muslim and then he killed himself, then it is permissible to make dua upon him and it could be recommended to make dua for him. Because the Prophet ﷺ made dua for him. And remember there was a time a person, he committed suicide. So I called one of my teachers in Medina and I said, look, Shaykh, someone has committed suicide. Is it permissible to pray the janazah over him? Because the Prophet ﷺ didn't pray the janazah over the person who committed suicide. He said, are you like the Prophet ﷺ? I said, no, I'm not. He said, the Prophet ﷺ didn't want to pray over him to show the people the severity of this action. Did he prohibit the Sahaba from praying over him? No, he never. So it shows you that the person should pray over him. Unless a person is someone in the community that if he wasn't to pray over this person, this will affect everyone and it will deter them from the act of suicide or the crime that this person was committing. So a person should pray, it's recommended to pray over him. Because he needs our du'as. He needs us to make du'a for him. He needs people to pray behind him. Because he has committed a major sin. So a person who commits a major sin, he's under the mashi'ah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, under the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah wants to punish him first and cleanse him, Allah will do this. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to forgive him completely and enter him into Jannah, he can do this subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is also unanimously agreed upon Ahl Sunnah is that this person, if he enters the fire of Jahannam, he will not remain there for eternity because he still died as a believer.
عن أنس بن مالك قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يتعوذ يقول اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الكسل وأعوذ بك من الجبن وأعوذ بك من الهرم وأعوذ بك من البخل
Now here the author rahimahullah ta'ala has mentioned a narration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and certain du'as that he used to make. So he said that Anas radiallahu anhu said in the hadith al-muttafaqun alayh, he said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتعوذ. يقول, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to seek refuge. And he used to say, and when we find these du'as of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, we should try and memorize them. And if we find it difficult to memorize them, we should at least try and say these du'as at least once in our life. So we have tried to implement every du'a that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has said. And this is what the ulama have mentioned, that if you find any sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then at least try and implement it once in your life if you cannot implement it consistently. At least try and implement it once in your life. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he used to seek refuge and he used to say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-kasl. Oh Allah, I seek your protection from being lazy, from laziness. Now imagine, subhanAllah, these are duas the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would make. And you can find that if the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, imagine now, if the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was given this and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was tested with being lazy, how would you have been able to spread the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So he used to make dua to Allah, oh Allah, protect me, I seek refuge in you from laziness. And that's why you find how he was able to achieve what he achieved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in such a short space of time. So this is a dua that we should make. Sometimes we would feel lazy. Some person should make the dua, oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from being lazy. And you do not have to have that feeling to make the dua. You should make that dua so you are not tested with this. And you are not made lazy, because if a person is lazy, his actions will come and he will leave the actions. Sometimes he would leave the voluntary actions, and sometimes it may even lead him to leave the obligatory actions. How many times do you find the salah of fajr will come and a person says, oh, later, because of laziness. And you would find that maybe he has missed the jama'ah. Or you would find now that maybe he has missed most of it, so there's only time for him to pray the farad. Or you would find that some people, they would keep saying late and later out of laziness until they've missed the entire action itself. So laziness is from the shaitan. And the Prophet ﷺ used to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from laziness. Then he said, وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنَ الْجُبْنِ. And I seek your refuge from cowardice. That he did not want to be a coward, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I seek refuge from this. Because if the person is made a coward, he's not going to be able to stand up to the enemy. And not only the enemy, he is not going to be able to speak the truth. Because when a person speaks the truth, there will always be enemies there. He will always have people that are against him. So if he is a coward, he will not be able to speak the truth. So the Prophet ﷺ used to seek Allah's protection from this. That, oh Allah, do not make me a coward. And he used to seek Allah's refuge, he used to seek the refuge of Allah Jalla wa'ala from this. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنَ الْهَرَمِ. And he seeks refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from old age. What does he mean here by old age? This is old age where a person becomes so weak that he becomes dependent on others. Now this is a type of old age which takes away the honor of a person. If someone has to take him to the bathroom, if someone has to help him shower, if someone has to help him wash himself, this takes the honor away from the person. So the Prophet ﷺ used to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this type of old age. Because he doesn't want to depend on anyone, nor does he want to humiliate himself in front of others and expose his private parts in front of others. So he used to make this dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنَ الْبُخْلِ. And he said, and I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from stinginess. And we know that he was ajwadun nas. He was the most generous of people sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there was no doubt that anything that he had, if somebody said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh, I like this, O Messenger of Allah, he would take it and he would give it to them. If he was wearing new clothes, someone said, I like the clothes you are wearing, O Messenger of Allah, he would take these clothes off and he would give it to them. Anything that he had, he would give it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was the most generous person and he used to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against stinginess. And then you can find that all of these qualities the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to seek refuge in Allah jalla wa ala from, he was the furthest away from any of these characteristics. There was no laziness in him. He was not a coward sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We took the hadith in the beginning of this kitab. When there was a loud bang and loud noise in Medina, what happened? The Sahaba, they gathered together and they rushed out to see what that noise was. And they found the Prophet ﷺ was already there with his sword, fearing that the enemy had come. Without notifying anyone, he went by himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was not a coward, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he used to seek Allah's jalla wa ala's protection from old age because he was completely dependent upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he never used to ask the creation for anything. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the furthest away from being stingy. So maybe because the Prophet ﷺ used to make these dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah jalla wa ala freed him from all of this. And that's why a person should use the du'as of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and make du'a using them, because they are the most purest du'as, because they have come from him sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Qala rahimahullah ta'ala, haddathana Khalifatun min Khayyar,
قال حدثنا كثير بن هشام قال حدثنا جعفر بن يزيد بن الأصم عن أبي هريرة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم قال قال الله عز وجل أنا عند ظني عبدي بي وأنا معه إذا دعاني.
Now the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, gives the hadith of Abi Huraira, which is also muttafaqun alayh. He said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قال الله عز وجل, that Allah عز وجل said. And now this is a hadith, Qudsi. But this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking. He says, أنا عند ظن عبدي بي. I am just as my slave thinks I am. وأنا معه إذا دعاني. And I am with him if he makes dua to me. Now, this is a very important hadith. And this is from the conditions of a dua being accepted. That a believer believes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept his dua. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أنا عند ظني عبدي بي. I am just as my slave thinks of me. If you think Allah is going to accept your dua, He will accept your dua. If you think Allah is going to reject your dua, He will reject your dua. If you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be merciful to you, He will be merciful to you. If you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to punish you, He is going to punish you. However you think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is how He is going to be for you. And that's why when a believer makes dua, and he has 100% conviction that Allah is going to accept my dua, this is when he will see that his dua is accepted. So this is from the conditions of dua, to have husnul dhan, to have good thoughts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe that our dua is going to be accepted by Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَنَا مَعَهُ إِذَا دَعَانِي. And I am with Him when He makes dua to me. I am with Him with my response. Allah is with them with His response, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is with them with His mercy, with His aid, with His assistance. And the part of the hadith that Imam Bukhari didn't mention, because he only mentioned the part he wanted to, and this is permissible for a person just to mention a part of the hadith. After this, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that Allah Jalla wa Ala said, فَإِن ذَكَرَنِي فِي نَفْسِي ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي نَفْسِي. When he remembers me in himself, or by himself, I remember him by myself. And some of the ulama have said this is an evidence, we spoke about this in the last lesson, that this is an evidence that it is permissible to make dua in oneself without moving the lips. We said when a person recites the Qur'an, he has to recite it with his tongue. And he cannot recite it in his mind. But when a person makes dua, it is permissible for him to make the dua just in his mind and his heart. But it is better for him to say it with his tongue. Because when I am by myself, when he remembers me by himself, it could also mean that when he remembers me and there's no one around him, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remember him by himself. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not even expose these good deeds to the malaika. So on Yawm al-Qiyamah, when the scrolls are there, these are not even written in the scroll, they are greater than this and they will be put on the scales. Because he remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this time of sincerity, that no one could see him and no one could hear him and no one knew about his affairs. And we can think the reason why Imam al-Bukhari mentioned the last two narrations in this chapter, because the chapter is about raising the hands, is that the previous narration where the Prophet ﷺ made dua, he said the asl is to raise the hands. So these are some du'as that you can make when you raise your hands. And also this chapter, that's why you should raise your hands, and this is from the etiquettes that you have good thoughts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you raise your hands to Him, and then He will give you whatever you ask for, subhanahu wa ta'ala.